Well, about 15, 20 years ago, I found a piece of pottery marked Waco pottery. And I already knew what Rookwood pottery was, which is famous Cincinnati pottery. And I have a curious mind, and I had to know where it was from because it was such a pretty piece. This is a story that needs to be told. It's Kentucky's long rifle of art pottery.
Well, there are 14 collectors involved in the show. We've identified probably twice that many collectors just in central Kentucky. Serious collectors with significant numbers of pieces in their collections. But we were able to select this show from about 14. The pots that we have in this exhibit are mostly from 1920 to 1945. We've focused on that particular sort of art pottery phase of the tradition in Madison County.
These are flower vases. These were on everybody's back porch and everybody's cupboard, and you can see they're just as pretty as anything that's ever been made, and it's just precious things that people took care of. They're hard. They ring like glass, some of them, and they bounce. So they fall over and they don't crack. They do of course crack, but they're very durable. It's one of the ways you can ID it if it's not marked, is that most of it has a nice ring to it. You can hear the sound of it when you touch it. So you can just hear it, you can hear it. You get used to it, you can touch it and hear the sound of it. It has a ring to it.
At Waco proper, what has become Waco proper, there were two potters that came in 1837, Matthew and Parker Grinstead, and brothers, and they set up a pottery at what later became Waco. And around that particular spot in the county grew up this tradition that extended into the 20th century.
One of the important things is this pottery is in Madison County because there's a natural clay in Madison County that was deposited, according to the Kentucky Geologic Society. The modern thinking is that one of the last glaciations blocked up the Kentucky River and turned it into a huge lake there. And this is runoff from the Appalachians, which were eroding. And it was cold, so there was no vegetation to kind of keep the soil and the rock intact, and it broke in the little fine pieces into very small particles and eroded down, and then this natural clay was deposited over eons and pretty much sitting on top of the ground rather than a rock that's deposited a layer. This is pretty much sitting on top of the ground. Around 1880, an article from the Richmond Register says they shipped 63,000 gallons of stoneware to Knoxville, probably by boatload down the Kentucky River, because it's Bybee's at the crossroads, and it's real close to the Kentucky River, and it's known that they shipped it upstream on canal boats, so they probably shipped it down, but they sold stoneware by the gallon, so that's 6,300 10-gallon churns in one sale, which might have taken them several months to make, but a tremendous amount of stoneware. And so the Bybee Pottery Company in Lexington, it's pretty confusing because everybody knows the Bybee Pottery Company in Madison County, and this is really the 20s Bybee Pottery Company. And it looks like, from the record, it was probably the Cornelison Pottery in Bybee, but then Gilson, the geologist, really gave them the name Bybee Pottery. Willard Gilson was an early Kentucky geologist that was hired by the state to run the Kentucky Geologic Survey. But he was a Harvard grad and knew, been to the cities. and seen the and been to museums and seen a really fine art pottery, and he saw what a product they were turning out in a shoeless, you know, poor county, and must have seen the clay they were using. And he got together a group of investors in Lexington, and that's where the Bybee Pottery comes from. And they started buying pieces from Bybee and Waco, which were the two operating potteries, at least at the time, and selling those locally in department stores. And that became really successful. So they bought the Clark Gate Company, which is on 7th Street, or was on 7th Street. And with an original investment from himself of $15,000, which today is a 12-fold multiplier. So Gilson put, $180,000 of his own money in it to begin with. They picked up a salesman from New York. Somehow, they really luckily picked up probably the best salesman in the country you could have found, and that was Howard Selden by late 1925. So, and Selden's sales were throughout the country. And eventually, Howard convinced them to put his name on the Bybee Pottery.
A lot of these potters were journeyman potters. They would move from place to place and back and forth. Even in Waco, one very well-known potter, Eb Stone, worked at all the pot. He worked at Waco, Bybee, and here in Lexington at the Bybee Pottery Company in Lexington. So they were really basically guns for hire wherever they could get a job. You know.
She was such a fine photographer. If you read the book about her, she probably died from the chemical she used to develop silver. She used the real old-time camera, not the newer cameras in the 20s. She was using the old-time with big glass negatives.
John Jacob Niles, the famous singer from Kentucky, was her assistant when she came through Kentucky and actually went to South Carolina and several other states. They created a whole series of photographs that illustrate the artist making various kinds of crafts, pottery and that sort of thing.
20s was a great time, before the Depression.
Economically, it was a very prosperous time. But you also had in play an interest in looking back at handmade things. The Industrial Revolution had made people aware of handmade objects, and there was a real revival of that kind of thing going on.
About 1924 is when they really expanded. They hired Mr. Cornelison to run the business. So they rented the potteries, they hired the people to run it, they paid them by the piece, and then really became even more successful. They sold public stock. They sold up to $50,000 worth of public stock. It's all over the paper. They're, you know, they've got a tourism guy. They've got a woman that runs the shop. They've got the bus running every 7.5 minutes to the plant. There's no place in town that bus runs every 7.5 minutes nowadays. They would have been able to produce 125,000 pieces a year. And things were really good until the Depression hit. That's probably what really killed it. And it was not cheap stuff. Some of the pieces were $7, $10. So $100 pieces, $150 pieces. Must have been a tremendous amount of pottery, which because it was fired at such a high temperature, is still left today. So it looks like it was made yesterday, but this is stuff that's almost 100 years old.